in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. I'll say that now.
I think it'll be more convenient if we are seated, so please be seated. I trust that everybody can actually see a copy of the prayer book. We're on the service of Holy Baptism, and we're on page 51. We will change pages as we go, and hopefully I'll be able to keep everybody up to scratch. We'll read the sentence. There is one body and one spirit.
There is one hope in God's
us. One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God and Father of all.
Baptism is the gift of our Lord Jesus Christ. When he had risen from the dead, he commanded his followers to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. We've come together this morning to obey that command. Baptism with water signifies the cleansing from sin that Jesus' death makes possible, and the new life that God gives us through the Holy Spirit. In baptism, the promises of God are visibly signed and sealed for us. We are joined to Christ and made members of his body, the Church Universal. Millie, children are baptized in response to God's all-embracing love. Parents and godparents who have responded to that love come now to bring Millie for baptism. Before this congregation, they must express their own trust and commitment to the promises of God and their intention to bring up Millie in the faith and practice of the Church. In due time, she should make her own response to God and be prepared for confirmation. So we do welcome Millie with all those who are here to support you, your sponsors and extended family. We give thanks for you, and we pray that you may know God's love and faithfulness forever. So let us affirm our trust in God's mercy and confess that we need forgiveness. Lord, you have created this world and made us in your own image. Forgive us when we turn away from you. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord God, through your Son, you overcame evil and death. Rescue us from slavery to sin. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord God, by your Spirit, you restore us to fellowship with you and with one another. Breathe your love and freedom into our lives. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you your sins and keep you in eternal life. Amen. The prayer today is printed on the pew slip. And in many ways, it's a summary of what we're doing here this morning. And I'd just like you to look at the words. We talk about the living water that springs from the rock who is our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And that's our prayer this morning. So I'd like you to read the prayer with me. O God, the fountain of life, to a humanity parched with thirst, you offer the living water that springs from the rock, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Stir up within your people the gift of your Spirit, that we may profess our faith with freshness and announce with joy the wonder of your love. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen. The readings are printed on the sheet, and the family are going to help us with the readings this morning.
A reading from Exodus, chapter 17, verses 1 through to 7. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages, as the Lord had commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. The people quarrelled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the people complained again. Moses said, "Why do you bring us out of Egypt?" And they said to Moses, my apologies, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock of Horeb. Strike the rock and water will come out of it so that the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massah and Meribah because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is it the Lord amongst us or not?" Thanks be to God. Psalm 95, and the response is, "If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts." If today you
hear his voice, harden not your
hearts. O come, let us sing out to the Lord. Let us shout in triumph to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his face with thanksgiving and cry out to him joyfully in psalms. For the Lord is great, is a great God, and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the peaks of the mountains are his also.
If they hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
The sea is his and he made it. His hands moulded the dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is the Lord our God. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Today, if only you would hear his voice. Don't harden your hearts as at Meribah, on the day at Massah in the wilderness.
Today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
When your forebears tested me, put me to proof, though they had seen my works, 40 years long I loathed that generation and said, "It is a people who err in their hearts, for they do not know my ways, of whom I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest."
For the second reading, I'll be reading Romans chapter 5, verse 1 to 11. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to his grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we're still weak, at the time Christ died for the ungodly, indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Much more surely then, now that we have been justified by his blood, we will be saved through him, the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more surely have been reconciled. Will we be saved by his life? But more than that, we even boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Thanks be to God.
I invite you now to stand for our gradual, our song before the gospel. happens to be a favourite of mine. Come, listen, live. I'm a schoolie. The gospel is quite long today, so please be seated. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John, chapter 4, beginning at the 5th verse. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. So Jesus came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired out by his journey, was sitting by the well. It was about noon. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?" Jews do not share things in common with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have no bucket and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us this well and with his sons and his flocks drank from it?" Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." The woman said, "Sir, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come back." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you say that the place where people must worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father seeks such as these to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, who is called the Christ. When he comes, he will proclaim all things to us." Jesus said to her, "I am he, the one who is speaking to you." Just then his disciples came. They were astonished to see that he was speaking with a woman. But no one said, "What do you want?" or "Why are you speaking with her?" Then the woman left her water jar and went back to the city. She said to the people, "Come and see a man who told me everything I have ever done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he?" They left the city and were on the way to him. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, "Rabbi, eat something." But he said to them, "I have food to eat that you do not know about." So the disciples said to one another, "Surely no one has brought him something to eat." Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to complete his work. Do not say 4 months more, then comes the harvest. But I tell you, look around you and see how the fields are ripe for harvesting. The reaper is already receiving wages and is gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I have sent you to reap for which you did not labour. Others have laboured and you have entered into their labour." Many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony. "He told me everything I've ever done." So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them. And he stayed there for 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It's no longer because of what you said that we believe, but we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Saviour of the world." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Let's just bow our heads in prayer. Father, we thank you for being with us this morning, and as we listen to the Gospel, there is much for us to take in. And as we celebrate the baptism this morning, we pray that each of us might refresh our commitment to you. In Jesus' name, amen. I didn't come to faith until I was 18, so I wasn't baptised as a baby, although probably some people would think I was babyish. And when we read the prayer book, we hear that baptism is one of what the prayer book calls a sacrament. And I always found that a difficult word to understand what we mean by sacrament. And in fact, maybe Jim and Barb might remember, I was in Africa with a group of people from Newcastle at a program called Casillo, and there's a talk on that, in that program, on the sacraments. And the African who was to take the talk had been called away to a wedding in Nairobi, we were in Kenya, and he hadn't come back. And one of my so-called friends says, "Well, I know what we can do. Father Chris can give the talk." And that was how much preparation I had. And I guess that's when you pray pretty hard. But what I came to understand is that Australians use a phrase and it really helps us to understand what we mean by sacrament. How often have you heard the phrase, "We shook hands on it"? I accepted a job in Scone and went back to my old employment, and the people up there said, "Have you got a new contract?" And I said, "No, I don't have a contract." "Well, what have you got?" I said, "I have a handshake." The handshake itself doesn't mean much, does it? It's just two pieces of flesh coming together. But it understands for something, helps us to understand something that is unseen. And the unseen bit was that we'd had an agreement, I was going to do a job and they were going to remunerate me and so on and so on. And that's really like baptism, isn't it? We don't have an English word Yeah, we don't have an English word for baptism, which we use very often. Now, I don't say, it's time for the kids to go to bed, I want you to be baptized. We don't say, we use the word bath or shower or wash or something. But the idea is the same, isn't it? When we wash our hands, the idea is we clean the rubbish off, don't we? We clean the rubbish off, and in cleaning the rubbish off, we're ready for a new start. And that's the story that we have in baptism. Jesus has given his life so that we can have a new start. Jesus has given his life so we can wash the rubbish off and begin again. Now, she's only 8 months. She's 8 months old. And so people have to stand beside her to support. And that's what the sponsors do. And when she comes to an age that she can answer for herself, she is able to actually affirm the promises that were made on her behalf. And in our tradition, that's why we have confirmation. If you turn in your prayer books, as I was explaining at the beginning, I'm an old schoolie. So if you turn in your prayer books, don't like find the page I want. We're at the bottom of page 57. What that does in that paragraph, which is headed baptism, is spells out for us our understanding of what it means to be baptized. And it focuses on the use of water. So in beginning was the creation, and creation brings new life. That's the first point that you can take from that. I'm not going to go through each of the individuals, but I want to actually give you somewhere you can go if you want to go and have a bit of a think about it. The second one, Moses led the Jewish people out of Egypt. The water separated and they escaped. They had a new life. So this is the idea of being led from slavery into freedom. The next point was that when Jesus was baptized, there was something that he was given. He was given the gift of God's Spirit. And so in baptism, we are given the gift of God's Spirit. And the next point that's made, the idea of washing is it's like dying with Jesus and coming back to life. And the final point which is made there, we give thanks for the grace of the Holy Spirit who forms us in the likeness of Christ and leads us to proclaim his kingdom. We do give thanks for Millie and we pray for her in her life ahead. Amen. Okay, we're on page 55. And so now I'm going to invite Mum and Dad and the sponsors, if you'd like to come out to the front. And the children, I need help, so I need the children to come too. Need to bring your green prayer books, please, because it's got the words in it. Thank you. Sorry. That's good. Got everybody to help. Okay, we welcome Millie who comes to be baptized, and I invite her sponsors to present her now. We've got the words in front of you there. We present. We present Millie to be baptized. Amen. Well, now I'm going to ask you some questions. Will you accept the responsibilities placed upon you in bringing Millie for baptism? Are you willing to answer on behalf of her? By your own prayers and example, by your friendship and love, will you encourage Millie in the life of faith and of Christian community? Okay, we turn the page. And again, I'm going to ask everybody, this will include Mum and Dad too, and to affirm the faith. Before God and this congregation, you must affirm that you turn to Christ and reject all that is evil. Do you turn to Christ?
I turn to Christ.
Do you repent of your sins?
I repent.
Do you reject selfish living and all that's false and unjust?
I reject them all.
Do you renounce Satan and all evil?
I renounce all evil.
Almighty God, deliver you from the powers of darkness and lead you in the light of Christ to his everlasting kingdom. Amen. Will you each, by God's grace, strive to live as a disciple of Christ, loving God with your whole heart and your whole neighbour as yourself until your life's end? Okay, that's the sponsors. Now it's our turn as the congregation. You have heard these, our brothers and sisters, respond to Christ. Will you support them in this calling? We're going to pray. Grant, merciful God, that Millie will be so buried with Christ in baptism that the new nature might be raised up in her. May the fruit of your Spirit grow and flourish in her. Give to her sponsors. Give to her sponsors and the extended family the desire to share with her what you have revealed in your holy gospel. May Millie know Christ's forgiving love and continue in fellowship and service in his church. May she proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ. Amen. We thank you for the ministry we have in your world and to each other in the household of faith. Hasten that day when the whole creation shall be made perfect in Christ. Amen. Now we come right to the baptism. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We give you thanks that at the beginning of creation your Holy Spirit moved upon the waters to bring forth light and life. With water you cleanse and replenish the earth. You nourish and sustain all living things. Thanks be to God. We give you thanks that through the waters of the Red Sea you led your people out of slavery into freedom and brought them through the River Jordan to new life in the land of promise. We give you thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, for his baptism by John and his anointing with the Holy Spirit.
Thanks be to God.
We give you thanks that through the deep waters of death Jesus delivered us from our sins and was raised to new life in triumph.
Thanks be to God.
We give you thanks for the grace of the Holy Spirit who forms us in the likeness of Christ and leads us to proclaim your kingdom. And now we give you thanks that you called Millie to new birth in your church through the waters of baptism. Pour out your Holy Spirit in blessing and sanctify this water. So I need some help to put the water in the bowl. Pour out your holy blessing and sanctify this water so baptized in it, may be made one with Christ in his death and resurrection. May she die for sin, rise in the newness of life, and continue forever in Jesus Christ our Lord, for whom we give you praise and honour in the unity of the Spirit, now and forever. Amen. I then ask everybody in the congregation to join us as we affirm our faith. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father, Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in God the Son?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, and our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried.
He descended
to heaven. On the third day he rose from heaven, and he ascended into
the faith of the church.
This is our faith. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And then we're going to light a candle. Can you do that for me? Right, now can you light the candle? There you go. I'll bring this down. No, I can't. Can you reach? I should have lit it before. It's just holding in there, but that's well done. Why do you think we use a candle? Because Jesus is the light of the world, isn't it? And so we just have a kind of symbol, don't we? So you're going to hold this for me, are you? Okay. So we're going to say to Millie, live as a disciple of Christ, fight the good fight, finish the race, keep the faith. Christ crucified, proclaim his resurrection, look for his coming in glory. So we've got the candle that symbolises Christ, the light of the world. God has brought you out of darkness into his marvellous light.
Shine
as a light in the world.
To the glory of God the Father.
God has called you into his church. Therefore, we receive and welcome you as a member with us of the body of Christ, as a child of the one heavenly Father, as an inheritor in the kingdom of God. Of the Mothers Union, who I can't see, here she is.
On behalf of the Mothers Union and all the congregation, this little pack, it's got some advice and some little bits and pieces. And welcome to the church.
Julie. We're on page 63. Father Neville will give the greeting. Please stand.
Would you all stand for the greeting? We are the body of Christ.
His Spirit is with us.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
We sing now our offertory hymn. 127 of the Green Prayer Books. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have all our gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom. Blessed be God forever. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
All glory and honour be yours always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever-living God. We give you thanks and praise for our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who by the power of your Spirit was born of Mary and lived as one of us. By his death on the cross and rising to new life, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Merciful Father, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and this wine. And we pray that by your word and Holy Spirit, we who eat and drink them may be partakers of Christ's body and blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup and again, giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Therefore we do as our Saviour has commanded. Proclaiming his offering of himself, made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Renew us by your Holy Spirit. Unite us in the body of your Son and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of never-ending praise. Blessing and honour and glory and power are yours forever and ever. Now turn over to page 141. On the top of the page, as our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are confident to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread.
Forgive us our sins.
as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body,
for we all share in one bread.
Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us your peace. Come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of the Lord in remembrance that Christ died for us, and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. If you are a baptized member of any other faith, you are very welcome to receive communion with us today. In light of the COVID problems that we have had here, there has been a few people who like to intinct, which means placing the wafer in the wine. That is very much frowned upon. It's, in fact, totally forbidden. So if you don't wish to take the wine, you simply place your hands around the common cup and you are taking it in spirit. the bottom of page 143. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us in this hope that we have grasped, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Father, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
We stand for our final song.